All children need an adult for stories, crafts, meal and fun. So, keep that in mind. These are all the intimations, I think. Let us worship God. Let us sing to his praise and glory. In hymn 93, let us, with a gladsome mind, praise the Lord.
Have been with you. Bless us today in worship.
his believing family. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power and the glory forever. Amen. Now it's time for our first scripture lesson, and it's going to be read for us by Brenda. It's from the Old Testament book of Ezekiel, a well-known passage, Ezekiel 37, beginning at verse 1. That's Ezekiel 37, beginning at verse 1. Hear the word of God.
The Valley of Dry Bones. The hand of the Lord was upon me, and he brought me out of the Spirit of the Lord, and set me in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me to and fro among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. He asked me, Son of man, can these bones live? I said, O sovereign Lord, you alone know. Then he said to me, Prophesy to these bones, and say to them, Dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you, and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you, and make flesh come upon you, and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you, and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded, and as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound, and the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, Prophesy to the breath, prophesy, son of man, and say to it, This is what the sovereign Lord says, Come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe into these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath entered them. They came to life and stood up on their feet, a vast army. Then he said to me, Son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, Our bones are dried up, and our hope is gone. We are cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, This is what the sovereign Lord says. O my people, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from them. I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord. When I open your graves and bring you up from them, I will put my spirit in you, and you will live. And I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken, and I have done it, declares the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Brenda. And now we continue in our worship by singing hymn 601, Look Upon. when the disciples saw the Lord, they were filled with joy. Jesus repeated, "Peace be with you," and said, "As the Father has sent me, so I send you." Then he breathed on them, saying, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive any man's sins, they stand forgiven. If you pronounce them unforgiven, unforgiven they remain." One of the 12, Thomas, that is the twin, was not with the rest when Jesus came. So the disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." He said, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, unless I put my finger into the place where the nails were, and my hands into his side, I will not believe it." A week later, his disciples were again in the same room, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them, saying, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Reach your finger here, see my hands, reach your hand here and put it into my side. Be unbelieving no longer, but believe." Thomas said, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said, "Because you have seen me, you have found faith. Happy are those who never saw me and yet have found faith." Amen, and may God bless to us these readings from his word. To his name be the glory and the praise. Now our prayers of thanksgiving and intercession, let us pray. The psalmist wrote, "Be still and know that I am God." Help us to be still in mind and in heart as we present to you now our prayers of intercession and of thanksgiving. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in his great mercy gives us new birth into a living hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. God our Father, we join with the whole church to celebrate the wonder of your love to us and to all people in Christ Jesus. We bless you for the continuing work of Christ through the Holy Spirit in bringing unity, new life and hope to the world. Praise and thanks to you, O God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. We give thanks for all who have built up Christ's Kirk in Scotland, especially those who have worked and prayed for its greater unity, unity without uniformity. May that unity increase with the years, and may it go from strength to strength, strong in the strength which God supplies through his eternal Son. Blessing and honour and glory and praise, this is the theme of the hymn that we raise. We pray now for Christ's church throughout the world, that the good news may be spread with clarity and with courage, with confidence and with compassion. We pray for our King and for our parliaments, for the well-being of our nation, for a deeper sense of community. Make our nation a truly united kingdom, reflecting your kingdom, the kingdom of heaven, one of peace, of joy and of love. We remember those in need, and again we pray urgently for those caught up in the terrible war in Ukraine. We pray urgently for peace in that land, in the name of the Prince of Peace. Pray for all who are anxious or oppressed or hungry, those who don't have the basic necessities of life. Let your spirit of reconciliation be shown in us, so that we and all your people, Lord, may be used for the increase of peace Christian book, and to give it such a title, it must have an element of courage too. But it is superbly written and takes its students and its readers through the mire of doubt, out into the clarity and certainty of the resurrection faith. The disciple I want to look at today, the last meantime in our series of disciples, because next week, as you may be aware, is the first Sunday in Advent, but the last disciple I'm looking at meantime is one who had the courage to doubt. My Lord and my God. The words of Thomas. Doubting Thomas. Jesus, as we read in John's Gospel, had appeared late in the evening to the disciples, very possibly in the upper room where the Last Supper had been held, before his death. As they met there in terror, they listened quickly and fearfully for every step on the stair, every knock at the door, lest the emissaries of the Sanhedrin should arrive and arrest them too. And suddenly, as they sat there, the risen Jesus was in the midst of them. Peace be with you, said Jesus. He said it more than once. Peace be with you. And then he gave them their great commission. As the Father has sent me, so I send you. And so their lives were suddenly transformed, set ablaze with the Holy Spirit of their Master when it breathed upon them. They were rekindled, they were recreated, renewed for the task Jesus had squarely set before them: to teach and baptize all nations and to establish his church in the world. Now the picture that we get here is similar to the one Brenda read to us from the Old Testament book of Ezekiel, prophet Ezekiel. Remember when he saw the valley of the dead, dry bones, and when he heard God say to the wind, "Come, O wind, from every quarter and breathe into these slain that they may live." Similarly, here in the presence of the resurrected Christ, the wind of the Spirit swept through the lives of the disciples, and they were thus revived and reawakened for the task ahead. But on that occasion, one of the disciples was missing, Thomas. Doubting Thomas, as he's frequently referred to. I think really proverbial language has over the years dealt a bit unkindly with Thomas. Certainly, of course, there's an element of truth in the cliche, a doubting Thomas. But there's much more to this courageous disciple than the popular cliche would suggest. In the Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, he only appears in the lists of the disciples. It's in John's Gospel that he appears and emerges as a man with certain definite characteristics. Thomas's first appearance in the New Testament scene was in the Lazarus story. I'm sure you'll remember it. News had come to Jesus that Lazarus, one of his closest friends, was ill, sick unto death in Bethany. Now for 2 days, on hearing this, Jesus did nothing at all. He didn't make a move, strangely. Then he told his disciples that Lazarus was now dead. "Our friend has fallen asleep," he said. And then he proposed what to the disciples seemed an incredible step. He said that he proposed to go to Bethany. Now Bethany, you may know, was a village only a few miles, is a village only a few miles from Jerusalem. The ruler coalition of believers. That's where they find certainty. You see, Thomas made one mistake. He withdrew from the Christian fellowship. What he had expected had happened, and when it came, in spite of the fact that he expected it, Thomas was heartbroken. So heartbroken, in fact, that he couldn't even face his fellow disciples. All he wanted was to be alone with his grief. It's recorded that the late King George V used to say that one of his rules of life was Take these gifts, O loving Jesus. Use them in some lovely way for the happiness and comfort of the whole wide world this day. Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne, hymn 459. The love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be among you this day and remain with you evermore.